it is illegal for you to record a telephone conversation with someone without that person's concurrence. And yet, it is legal for the government to run this kind of surveillance.
Welcome to Correspondence. Today we're discussing the much debated US snooping program, PRISM. The first time this hit the news screens, the first thing that came to my mind was a passage of conversation in the movie A Few Good Men. You had Colonel Jessup sitting in a courtroom being tried by a young Tom Cruise. And what he said to him was something that, you know, is stuck with me. He basically said, "I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide, and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just say thank you and went your way. Otherwise, I suggest you pick up a weapon and stand a post." Now, is that the truth about PRISM that we aren't quite ready to handle? Sitting with me here today are three gentlemen who are going to help us get to the bottom of this. We have advocate of the Supreme Court, Pavan Dugal, sitting with me. He's also a cyber laws expert and will help us understand the legal ramifications of all of this. Of course, we've got Mr. Ravi Prasad, who is a telecom consultant, and he will be briefing us on the larger ramifications of PRISM. And we have editor-at-large Ajit Sahi with us here. My first question to you is, basically, sir, there has been a lot of talk about the scope and the sheer size of this US snooping program, but we still don't know. I mean, people have been talking about huge databases, people tapping into Facebook, people tapping into Google, reading every message. What exactly is PRISM and what is the magnitude of it?
Well, there's been a lot of debate about this, and what people are people have known that the surveillance has been going on, but what people did not know that it is the sheer extent at which surveillance was being done of almost 100% of the citizens and almost 100% of their communications. But actually, international snooping by USA's National Security Agency has been going on ever since the start of the Cold War. In fact, in the 1950s and 1960s, you had a Project Echelon of USA's National Security Agency, which tapped each and every international phone call going into and out of the US. Even though USA always said that they never spied on the phone calls of their own citizens, but actually USA's National Security Agency was doing this. And their Project Echelon was actually a joint venture of USA's National Security Agency, Britain's GCHQ, and the intelligence agencies of Australia and New Zealand. And they'd set up a series of listening posts all over the world, basically on small islands in the oceans, which actually intercepted each and every international satellite communications. For instance, every satellite communication in the world of every country was being recorded and was being analyzed. And this had been going on ever since the 1950s. And the way they got around US law was that they did the interception outside US territorial waters. So they could say that, okay, we don't snoop on the domestic communications of Americans, but they were doing it for all the international communications, not just of Americans, but of everyone in the world.
Okay.
Well, I mean, 100% of satellite conversations were in the world were being
monitored.
Were being monitored and recorded. But the problem is that they were all overwhelmed with so much of data because there are millions of conversations going on. And to actually analyze 1 hour's worth of data would take them like 2 to 3 months.
Yeah.
So they started developing kind of ways of looking only at certain keywords, certain key people talking to each other. But again, still they were overwhelmed with so much of data that they had a backlog of 20 or 30 years of analysis of data. And that's why you had all these data mining techniques to look for certain keywords. But really it was not a success because no terrorist is ever going to say bomb or ammunition or gun,
yeah,
or I'm going to assassinate someone. They'll also talk in their own coded language. I think, for instance, the Indian terrorists, some of these Islamic terrorists were using words like aapne pooja kiya hai, aapne aapne ye kya murti par mala chadha hai, you know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
To say, have you placed the bombs, have you placed the explosives.
And so, Mr. Dugal, I wanted to, something that you know, sir touched upon here was that initially that they kept all these listening posts outside American soil and thereby got around the legality of it. What is the legality of a system like PRISM? Are there secret court orders that we don't know about that sanction all this? And is that enough for us to say, okay, this is fine, this is authorized?
I think we have to understand one fundamental premise. Today's world is a different world than what was two or three decades back. When internet has made geography history, it also had come to some dramatic changes. One of the dramatic changes have been that a majority of internet traffic flows through America. This is thanks to historical reasons. A majority of the servers of the internet are located there. Now, the moment data and information in the electronic form is flowing through a computer network which is physically located within the jurisdiction of a country, it automatically becomes amenable to that jurisdiction. And that being so, the government of that land is well within its powers to say, this is the data that's flowing through my networks and I'm entitled to have a peep at that. Whether I have a legitimate peep or whether I have an unofficial look is a call that will need to be taken. But the fact remains that this unique kind of a situation has led to programs like PRISM coming in. Now, PRISM is a program that has actually been, thanks to legislative action and the development of a code in this regard. What exactly is covered under there is still a matter of, debate, because there are no official confirmations yet.
Yeah.
But having said that, we have to today realize that the moment we are on a networked world, the concept of privacy has to evaporate instantaneously. So if you are using the internet or if you're using common networks for the purposes of communication, any expectations of privacy has to be come to a knot from the word go.
Okay.
And this PRISM is only reiterating that particular phenomenon. Again, majority of details are not much known, so the legalities can't be much debated about at this juncture.
Ajit, I wanted to bring you in on this. I mean, again, like what we've been talking about, spying, everyone does it. We've known that it's been going on. Governments have been spying on governments. I mean, the whole Cold
Kings
War.
Kings and dictators and monarchs.
Forever. Spies have
forever.
Always been there. And the whole thing is that why is there this outrage? Why is there this shock when we know that this happens? Is it because the internet is the last bastion of freedom and that's why we're feeling this sudden pinch?
Okay, so you started by talking about a movie, a Hollywood movie. Let me refer you to another English movie, which is called The Bridge on the River Kwai.
Yeah.
It's an old movie. And what happens in that movie is that the head of a military unit, an army unit, was captured by the enemy, their enemy. He and his men are used to build a bridge over a river. And he gets so involved in the construction of the bridge that he forgets where does his morals and his ethics lie. The question fundamentally here is, as Pavan said, US has most of the servers, therefore it has a legitimate right. Just think about it. Suppose historically this had not happened in the US, had it happened in Russia, this development of the internet industry, would the US have quietly sat down and said Russia has... No, the US would have pushed for an international regime where they would have said that this, because there's international traffic flowing through it, this should be international property, there should be international norms governing it. So the US is basically a country that believes in having its cake and eating it too. It's very ironic, and I completely agree with Pavan when he says that concept of privacy has to evaporate. Now look at the irony of it. PRISM says, the US says, your privacy has to evaporate, but my privacy to run a program like PRISM should stay in place. How is that possible? You know, I think Julian Assange has said something very, very important. He has said this is a losing battle for authoritarian governments in the world over, because they will always need nerds and geeks and digital guys like Edward Snowden, like Edward Sorokin, who committed suicide, because without them these programs cannot be run by any government.
Yeah.
And these are the young people who will constantly battle the authoritarianism inherent in such a program. I just want to make one more point about this, which is, does it benefit? I think the jury is still out whether such programs actually bring any semblance of good intelligence. On the other hand, we are seeing in Gujarat what's happening. I mean, the level of intelligence is pathetic. There is no oversight. There's virtually no oversight. I was trying to read up yesterday on what is happening in the United States in terms of oversight, congressional oversight, judicial oversight, executive oversight in the United States of the various intelligence agencies. And they have a labyrinthine of networks, of systems in place, and even they don't work. Even they don't work.
Yeah.
Here in India, it's a black hole. Intelligence is a black hole. All that the Intelligence Bureau needs to do is go to a court of law and say, or the prosecution needs to say, this was an input from the IB and that's it. No judge even asks, okay, bring me evidence to prove that this was accurate input, intelligence input. It's a black hole.
Now, Ajit touched upon a few points that I wanted to get into. I mean, for me, largely, if you look at how time of history is divided, the time frames, you have BC, you have AD, and then subsequently you have post 9/11. And post 9/11, for me, really changed the dynamics of the world. America has launched this new war on a new enemy, and the new form of warfare is collection of information. And therefore, as Ajit says, you have all these agencies which are snooping, spying, collecting information. You said they have lots of information, don't know what to do with it. But President Obama's defense was there's no such thing as 100% freedom. You need to get security in. This is the same thing that other government officers of the US government said, that, you know, to find the needle in the haystack, you have to make the haystack. It's about spreading the web. That's what a lot of this comes down to, civil liberties versus security. And in a place like India, where we have, you know, situation like Gujarat, Kashmir, the Northeast, this debate is there. Where would you stand on it? I mean, what do we think about it?
Well, we have to realize from a legal perspective that we are absolutely at a virgin ground. India still does not have a dedicated privacy legislation. The Supreme Court has read the Fundamental Right of Life under Article 21 of the Constitution to include the right to privacy.
Yes.
However, that is only enforceable against state action, and that right to life and privacy can only be, shall I say, excluded in accordance with procedure established by law. So the fundamental issue is, what is this procedure established by law? The only procedure established by law in India is the procedure under the Information Technology Act 2000, which is India's mother legislation dealing with the electronic format. Section 69 of the IT Act clearly says that the government, post now the 2611 Mumbai attacks, have unprecedented powers of interception, monitoring, decryption and blocking. Of course, they can be exercised under certain limited parameters. That's in the interest of sovereignty or integrity of India, security of the state, friendly relations with other nations, defense of the state, and public order and the like. Who's going to determine what comes within
exactly.
Therein? That's a huge black hole.
Absolutely.
Further, there's no transparency. More significantly, the adequate checks and balances do not exist. Yes, you have the IT interception rules 2009, which say prior to any interception or monitoring, please get a competent authority's order, which is the Home Secretary in the central government, in writing, which should authorize you to intercept or monitor. The way the law has been drafted, it appears that it is aimed to deal with specific instances of monitoring and interception. The law was never drafted to come across with a wide net of mass monitoring of mass sections of the population. So there are huge gray areas, and currently, till such time this matter is adequately decided, we will still have to be groping in the dark.
But again, it says a person has to be monitored for a specific reason, and that reason, you have to say that we suspect this person of such and such a thing, or we suspect that people living in this building are doing this activity.
Yeah.
It doesn't envisage that the entire population is going to be monitored all the time, 24/7, 365.